another source of mild depressive thoughts, or perhaps depressive thoughts for cricketers, and you would know this as well, having played 99 first class matches, you're traveling a lot as a cricketer, right? So when you're traveling to all parts of the country, all parts of the world, you're often spending a majority of the year away from home, away from family, right? So a lot of them actually experience homesickness as well, especially in your, when you might be alone in your hotel room, right? So it might seem like a royal jail. That's what Virat Kohli calls it. When he's in these fancy hotels, it seems like a royal jail at times. Is that something that players, I'm guessing nearly every single player who's playing at the international level, has to deal with? And if so, how can they best deal with this, given the fact that, you know, it's something that's unavoidable?
That's a very good question you asked. So there are many angles to this. So when you're traveling, of course, you're away from your loved ones, from the people that you can be very comfortable with the people that you can disclose and share your feelings, emotions, and thoughts. So one of the things, very important thing for a human being, is to get that connection with some one other person where they can just be vulnerable. Vulnerability is something that is very important for a person, where you let your guard down and you just be yourself. Otherwise, all the time that we are always wearing a mask, we're always trying to, pretend. We're trying to hold on to a lot of things that we're not giving up. I think in the initial part of the interview, you asked about emotions, right? So if you're just penting up all the emotions, it's always very important to, show your emotions and let it out. You can't pent it up all the time. So what happens when you're traveling is that you don't trust enough people around you. If you don't, and if you can't express what is going on with you, and if you can't share some of the anxieties and some of the moments that you have, that you want to let it out, you can't do it, and it just keeps building up. One other thing is, the social structure is very important. I don't know how far it is true, but if you look at relationship-oriented countries, we have these support structures. We can just go about, reach out to anybody. We can talk to them about anything. But there are certain countries which are task-oriented, where they are more in silos, and they're a lot more independent. So there, this is a lot more prevalent, where they feel more lonely. They don't know whom to go and talk to. The social structures are not really, it's not structured like that. That's with traveling and being away from people. There's one other very important aspect is when you're traveling, you don't get enough rest and sleep. Sleep is very, very important for physical well-being and mental well-being. And when you're traveling, because of jet lag and because of the time zones and other things, if you lose sleep, then you've not rested your mind, you're not your body. That's why when I talk about the serotonin, the melatonin, and then all of those things, these are the very hormones that will calm a person down. When you sleep, you need the melatonin. It'll calm you down. It'll just take away all those thoughts. When you sleep, obviously your thought activity will come down, and that is very, very important. But if you don't sleep, and if you constantly keep on encouraging those thoughts in the head, then you'll be a mental wreck. So that's another thing when you travel. If you can't sleep well, if you don't follow a proper routine going. So what's the advice? People say that you should have a routine. You should sleep at the same time and wake up at the same time. It can be 12 midnight and wake up. Maybe you can wake up at 6, 7, 8, but then keep that as a routine. Maintain it. If you want to sleep at 10 and wake up at 6, so be it. But maintain a routine. Why do they say that? Nowadays, like you asked, some of the really high performance zones of athletes and performers, they also have a sleep coach along with some of these strength and conditioning coaches. A sleep coach they take because they know the difference between a gold medal and a bronze medal or a silver medal is proper sleep. It can be that critical element. So sleep is very important. And if people who are really very anxious, and they have different time zones, they can't sleep. And simply because of so much of activity going on. To add to the other things that I mentioned, these are some of the other things that will add to the depression and add to this kind of a mental illness state.
Makes sense. And you touched on sleep. Before moving on to my next topic, which is how physical fitness and mental fitness can complement each other, just one question on sleep. You know, you hear of these outliers, like Shah Rukh Khan, Indra Nooyi, people who can survive on, say, 5 hours of sleep, Narendra Modi as well, Donald Trump apparently sleeps 5 hours every night. How do they still manage? You know, especially given the fact that, you know what, they're still in very, very important positions, right? Decision-making is a vital part of their role. They're paid to make good decisions, right? Because their judgment's much better than the judgment of other people. How can they still survive with 5 hours of sleep? Is it genetic in some cases where people can actually work with less hours of sleep compared to others?
Yeah, so there is no particular number that people suggest that you must have 8 hours of sleep or there is 6 hours, 7 hours. It's again very, very, very individualistic.
Okay.
The important thing is it's quality of sleep, right?
Yeah.
So how many hours you sleep, it can be 10 hours, but then if you have just had 3 hours of quality sleep, when I say quality sleep, the activity in the brain is really low.
Yeah.
That is proper rest. And some of these people who can operate, even if you look at Narendra Modi, he says he sleeps just a few hours and then he's... So they're all outliers, like you rightly said. But the brilliant point is, when they sleep, they sleep. Their activity, the brain activity is, I think, they know how, or it's natural, or they have this real way of seeing the world that will allow them to shut down, right? So it's again a combination of things. Like I said, how you look at things and how you perceive things is what will make you who you are. You're not like the way you're like the way you see things, right? And how you understand things. And I think these people know brilliant ways to just shut themselves off, tune in and tune out. So if many times, that's why if you're just sitting in a place and you close your eyes for 10 minutes, and if you can just bring your brain activity to the minimum, you feel refreshed. Even a 10 minute closing of your eyes and just, resting can rejuvenate you. So that is something that they can do. It need not necessarily mean that you need to go flat, horizontal on the bed and sleep. They know how to re-energize themselves with these short breaks and reducing their brain activity. And that's something that I think is what they are very good at, and they can function normally.
Earlier on in the discussion, we touched a bit upon physical fitness, and we talked about how, you know, you can cultivate good physical fitness. Similarly, you can cultivate good mental fitness as well, right? But of course, both aren't independent, right? Both are interrelated in many ways. I'll give you my example. Like, whenever I go hit the gym, I just feel good about myself, right? The endorphins flowing in my body. I feel mentally good about myself, right? I feel much more active at work. Similarly, the reverse is also true. When I'm not feeling good about myself mentally, when I feel down and out, say I may have had a fight with someone, my relationships aren't quite going well, I'm not enjoying work, right? That's when, even if I may have gotten, say, 8 hours of sleep under my belt, I still will lack the enthusiasm, the motivation to go to the gym. In fact, if I'm happy, if I'm feeling good about myself, I can probably hit personal records at the gym with 5 hours of sleep, right? Versus, you know, sleeping for 8 hours, but not feeling good about myself and not having a good workout. And so how are physical fitness and mental fitness interrelated?
So it's a funny thing, right? So if you tell somebody when they're attending an interview, you advise them to have their chest out and have a smile on the face. Why would you do that? There are a lot of training programs where we tell people, when you receive a phone call, for all these telemarketing people or even otherwise, when you get a customer call, when you're talking to them, you have a smile on your face. It's not that they can see it. Why would you do that? Because when you smile, it's a physical thing. It's a physical act. But the message that goes to the brain is that everything is fine and you're feeling great. If your chest is out, immediately you cheat your brain to thinking that I'm the best or I'm confident. If you keep your head high and walk tall, when you walk tall, it's a message that goes physical body language to the mind to suggest that, hey, you know, you're like really strong and good. So that's the simple connection that I can tell you how your body can influence the mind. And like you said, if your mind is feeling really sad and if you're depressed or unresourceful, then you slump and you frown automatically. So it's interrelated. So what would you do with it? You can play around with it. The time when you are really down and out, you just have to put your chest out, stand up, and just, you know, pretend that you're smiling. the laughing. So these are the really simple ways to alter the mind by altering your physical state, right? So this is the connection, and this is simply it's a simple connection that I can bring in. However, like the other example that you gave is when we run long distance running, when you have to run for over 45, your body sends messages saying that I can't do it. Your brain keeps saying that, oh, it's really, I want to stop. But then if you continue on, what happens is, so when we go for these long runs, it is just not to build physical strength physically, but it's also to build in your willpower. So when you run for long hours, it's like you accomplishing a tough task. What happens when you accomplish something which is a little challenging? Then you feel great about it. You feel good about it. Your perception about yourself is that, hey, you know what? I could achieve it. So fundamentally, human beings want to learn, excel, and grow. That's the primary function that we all have. We always want to learn, excel, and grow. So when you learn something, then you're no longer interested in that. I mean, if you achieve something, like if you play a video game, you're not playing your level one all the time. Once you've accomplished the level one, you're looking for level two because it gives you more challenges. And when you accomplish level two, you get a high, and then you want to try the next level. So I think when you work out, like you said, in the gym for a few hours, and then you know you've accomplished something. So this is how the collection is, because it's all the perception of who you are, what you are to yourself. So if some people can perceive themselves and they can occur to themselves as, even after not working out, if I'm the best, I mean, they're still, they can still be in the best state of mind even without having to work out. I mean, if you can find that way of perception and perceiving yourself that you're the best, irrespective of what you do or what you don't do. But at the end of the day, there is a connection between the physical body and the mental, because it's you, and you need it. It's the primary need for human beings, because when you sense threat, your limbs will have to support it. You need to either run or you need to fight. So that's the connection. Otherwise, there's no survival.
Exactly. And I think what you talked about is also called the power pose, right? Where you spread yourself out wide. That's one of the reasons why I think chimpanzees, gorillas, apes also thump their chests whenever they've attained victory, whenever they want to, you know, announce that they're the kings.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So if you look at a lot of sportsmen also, if you look, I don't know if you, in our growing up time era, Viv Richards was one of the guys that bowlers dreaded. So he would walk, his walk would itself, suggest to others that the bowlers and the opposition that he is there. I mean, he's like really menacing, but he would say that deep down, it's not that he was feeling, he was also getting those jitters and nerves, but he would just deal with it by the power walk, you can call it.
Understood. And so, Dave, talk to us a bit about the effect of social media on mental health. Social media, of course, in today's day and age, it is necessary in many ways, right? People are building their personal brands. People want to, you know, broadcast their message to the world, right? It's almost as if like everyone has become like an independent journalist in a way, right? You might want to tell your story to the world. But at the same time, people might consider it to be a necessary nuisance as well, right? You might exploit it, you might abuse it, right? And you might suffer from some of the negative consequences of overuse of social media. I'll give you Virat Kohli's example. You may have come across this. Initially, Virat Kohli, during his initial playing days, he used to post a lot on social media and used to check all the comments that were coming in, right? So whenever he scored a century, people are praising him, people actually showering him with accolades, right, and praise. But then what happened was, if say he gets out for a duck in the next game, right, the same person who was, you know, showering praise on him will now start abusing him, right? And that's when Virat was like, my God, like, he's so fickle. He was just telling me that I'm the best batsman in the world, and now he's abusing me, right? Isko main ab dikhaunga. So Virat was like, you know, I started playing the game just to prove this random guy who's in some random part of the world that I don't know, just to prove him wrong or her wrong, right? And that's when he was like, you know what, I'll still post on social media, but I'm never going to check the reactions. I'm never going to check the comments, right? So that's how he shielded himself from the dark side of social media. So what do you think players can do such that they don't quite suffer from like some of the negative aspects of social media?
Yeah, I think you mentioned it. So the real, it's a boon and a bane. I mean, you need to know how to use it to the best of your advantage, for your advantage. But otherwise, if you're using it to get you know, acknowledgements and self-approvals from others, social approvals, if it is a tool to, you know, feel good about yourself because somebody else says you're good, like I said, the social mirror, you don't necessarily, you know, you are using it wisely. But what happens, like you rightly said, if you live by the sword, you die by the sword. If you think that your life is going to be great and you're feeling your emotions, you're feeling very happy because you get those thumbs up and the likes and the hearts and all that. What happens when you don't get it? You're going to have a yo-yo effect. You're going to be feeling great at one point in time, and the rest next, you'll be thrown down. So when we were playing as sportsmen, the job of the press reporter is just to show everything and critique on everything. So some of the days when you know it didn't go well for you, you know, they would write a lot of things that they felt went wrong and about you, and they judge and they write. And then when you read it, obviously, you know, you don't like. And in the social conditioning that we have grown up with is, every time, you know, we are compared to others and say, see, he got a rank or he got first class, and what did you do? And then when you do well, they'll say, wow, great, and they throw a party. And when you don't, then you might just have a bit of advice. So all this takes away this ability in us to acknowledge ourselves. So we always wait for somebody else to let us know how we feel. But we always know, when you really connect to yourself, you know when you do something good and you have to feel good about it yourself. That ability is lost somewhere down the line because of the social conditioning. We need to reconnect back to that. So when you do something well, when you can accomplish something, you got to pat your own back. You need to understand that, hey, you know, this was the goal and this is something that I wanted to do. And when I've achieved it, then I can celebrate. I know that I've done it well. I don't need someone else to tell me that. Many times it so happens that even though you know that you've done it well, you can't rest till somebody else says that, hey, you know, you did that well. And that is this conditioning that is coming in. It's not just enough that you know you've done well. You want other people to tell you. And this is the social, man is a social being, and that comes from that, because you want to be, you know, included. You want people to include you, want people to recognize you and want to accept you. All of that is coming from the need, the social need, which is a reptilian need. But right now, if you can manage it, if you can be aware of the fact that, hey, this is coming from that need, it's a reptilian, it's a very basic innate need that I'm looking for social approval, then you can do something about it and say, hey, you know, I don't need it. I actually don't need it. I know I'm good. So social media is just that. It is just people to get more and more people to like them. So the more number of likes doesn't mean that you're a great person. So the self-worth, again, you can't attach these things to your self-worth. Your self-worth should come from your own practices, your own habits, your own principles and work ethic, which is in your control.
Exactly. And in today's day and age, I think a lot of people, instead of actually seeing themselves for who they are, they see themselves for who society thinks they are. And so once society has a certain perception about them, they'll bend over backwards to make sure that, you know what, whatever they do is in line with the perception that society has of them. So, you know, if you've maintained like a certain image of yourself on Instagram, now you have to make sure that, you know what, you maintain that image just so that, you know, society thinks that you're a consistent human.
So that's what, when you said it's a social mirror, social approvals is one of the most important topics in mental toughness coaching. There are different personalities. A lot of them, the social approval is very, very important. Some of them, it is not as much. So each one has a different challenge, which we deal with.
And the last topic that I have on my mind, Sujit, of course, these are very testing times for everyone, given the pandemic right now, given all the constraints that that everyone is facing, not just athletes. But what can athletes do? So I said, you know, once tournaments resume again, right? Once they're back out onto the field, how can they enter the zone as quickly as possible? I was reading your blog as well, and you talked about, you know, seven ways in which athletes can be in the zone, right? So how can they actually get back to that element inside the mind and in the zone?
See, the, when we talk about the zone, it is during the performance. I mean, when they are actually getting into a sport and they have to get into a performance zone, arena. So that's the zone. And not always can you get into the zone. You can only do certain things in your control and hope that you get into the zone. When you're in the zone, you're in the bubble, and then you just, you're not thinking about anything negative. Things go, it's automaticity, everything just flows. But it's quite different now. To get in the zone is more than saying that how will they get back into the zone, how will they now not lose perspective and lose the self-confidence is the real question. So it can happen that, you know, there are different kinds of players. Some of the players who believe that they need to put in so many hours of practice for them in order for them to do well. And that's, again, it's not a fact. It could be their perception. It could be their meaning that they have put for themselves. So these kind of players, they have to watch out for that. Because obviously they can't put in so many hours of practice. So then what they have to make do with whatever that they have as preparation. They have to turn up. They have to get the job done. So how can they do it? So they need to they get into a trusting mindset. They need to be able to trust themselves that they have done enough hard work already. They have self-belief in them. And with whatever little practice and whatever little getting back into the game that they get, they should be looking at, hey, you know, I've done enough. Let me bank on my own innate ability, my own developed ability, my work ethic from the past, my past successes. They got to relate to that. And if they can do that, then they can get in the zone again. Otherwise, they're always going with the self-doubt. You know, I'm not practiced enough. How can I play well? I'm obviously not going to play well. And if they get into that kind of a state of mind, they might not be able to perform. But there are some other athletes who have a trusting mindset, but they don't have a practice mindset. They don't require as many practice hours, but they still walk in saying that, hey, you know, I don't need so many. I can just do it. But they also need to watch out if they slacken up now. Because even those kind of athletes would get some amount of practice, some amount of activity. So if it is not done now, if they just slacken, and if they don't physically keep themselves fit, and if they don't think about the game, then they might fail, and then slowly they might start losing confidence. So what I can tell sportsmen now during the lockdown is just to focus, just to build that kind of a routine. You know, most of them would have had a routine. All sportsmen will have a routine. They wake up, they have every week, they'll have so many gym sessions, so many practice sessions. There is a particular time they wake up, a particular time they sleep. But during these times, it can just go haywire. So one thing that they need to really do is get the control back. They need to do certain things in the same way so that it is not completely off. And if they practice all of these things, and there are a lot of things that I mentioned, a couple of other people had interviewed me. So there is a physical practice, but there is also a mental practice. It is just like you playing a round of golf. I mean, I read a story where a golfer was convicted falsely and he had to be in prison for a few years. And he was a professional golfer. So when he came back after a few years, golf is a sport that requires really a lot of deliberate practice for you to keep the scores well. But this guy comes out of the prison, and when he plays, people didn't expect him to do well. I mean, but then he did exceptionally well. And why did he do well? He said, every day in the cell, what would I do? I would play the golf in my mind. I would go out, I would play the first hole, the second, and all the 18 holes. I would imagine the courses that I played, and I would actually literally play the course many times sitting there. So what happens there is the connection with your thoughts and the same kind of muscles are in play. So when he's imagining him hitting a shot, then the same kind of muscles are activated. And that's the kind of muscle memory he could maintain. And that's the kind of feel and the confidence. So if you take a leaf out of that, what he shared, these athletes who are especially in the high performance, they should spend some time to really experience and imagine that they are in some practice area, or they're performing a match, or recollect some of the best performances. They have to do this visualization and the imagery work. And if they continue to do this, they can retain some of this ability of theirs and the confidence and the self-esteem.
Brilliant. This reminds me of a couple of anecdotes that I've read about Steve Smith as well. Like oftentimes in the hotel room, wherever he might be, inside his house with his family, with his children, he's oftentimes just shadow batting. Like sometimes even at 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, the members of the Australian team who are staying in the same hotel as Steve might just end up hearing, you know, these loud thuds coming from the ceiling, and they text the WhatsApp group that they have saying, "Oh, is Steve Smith awake right now batting?" And Steve replies, "Yes, I am."
Yeah. So that reminds me of Rahul Dravid as well. Rahul Dravid also, even after scoring 10,000 test runs, he would stand in front of the mirror and practice his drives and shots. So, yeah, I mean, that's what makes them great and champions.
And Sujit, that just reminds me of one more question, which is going to be my last one. Talk to me a bit about the idiosyncrasies that different players had, you know, before they stepped onto the field. I think Sachin liked listening to some music, you know, some Lata Mangeshwar music, some very calming music. I think others like taking a shower right before they went out to bat. Some people like reading a book. So do you remember any of the idiosyncrasies of the players that you shared the dressing room with?
Not really. I can't remember. I mean, I remember some of... So it is the routine that they have, right? It's just a trigger that will get them into the zone and they can... I mean, the question is really what idiosyncrasies each one had. Is that the question that you had or why do they have?
Which ones they had? Like any interesting stories? Like of what?
Also, for a brief while, Rahul and I played a lot of cricket together from the junior levels. We played for the state, senior state, right, same game and all of that. So for a long time, he had a lot of idiosyncrasies. Rahul had a lot of them. Initial under 90, under 15, under 17, under 19 days, he would walk before walking into the ground to bat when his turn comes. The ground would have a white chalk powder to mark the boundary line. So he would take that and he would put it on his forehead and then walk. So he would do that for a while till somebody told him, "Arey, what is this?" And he got some logical thing. And then for a long time, Rahul used to wear some... He had to have something new on himself when he went to bat. So he had to wear something new. So I guess... If these are some of these are things like superstitions. I think these are some, if you have another name to this, it's a superstition. What the superstition actually does is that they get into this kind of a zone, the focused state of mind. When you do this, then it's a physical act, can give a message to the brain that, hey, you know, you're getting ready for battle. And then you have all the things that you have, that you're required to have. And it makes them feel confident that you've done everything and you're ready for it. So that is why people do and have these superstitions. So my advice is that have a superstition that you can manage and you can repeat it easily. If you have to wear something new every day, then your bank account will be zero at point in time. Or it is practically difficult. So that's why you have to give it up. I mean, make something, I mean, as long as it gives you the confidence and gives you this resourceful state of mind, superstitions are fine. It can be rash, but it makes sense to them because they can turn on the game face.
Right. And I guess that's one of the reasons why people may like listening to a specific song as well, right? Because they associate that song with something else. Say, for instance, the first time that they actually listened to that song, they were probably in a very happy state of mind, right? They probably had just won, attained victory. And so whenever they listen to the song in the future as well, they're reminded of those happy times.
Yeah, so these are all triggers, right? So it's when you look at something, it will remind you of something that you had experienced. So you attach your experience, your state of mind to some one element. And if you present that element, then that will also bring back all of those resourceful state of mind. So it's a good thing for people if they know what can really help them out. And if they have something like that, it can be used as a tool. It's just a tool that people use.